Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to today's Token Post interview. Today we have invited Mr. Igor Artamonov, the CTO of Ethereum Classic. Hello.
Hello.
So, let's get into the interview. Could you give a brief introduction about yourself and how you got into the crypto market?
Okay. Oh, that's a big question, actually. So first thing I need to mention, the CTO of ETC. And I think I'm CTO of ETC dev team, which is one of the team working on ETC. And I think it's important. So how I got into cryptocurrencies, that's a long story. I don't know. I was always interested in that. So I think I started to do some experiments, some mining, even like basically. I'm not a miner, but tried to mine in 2014 or 13 maybe. There was this previous hype, the spike in price, and
yes.
that about this moment. I was being interested in this, and then Ethereum was a great idea. I followed that idea. I was working on my own project. My background is I'm a software engineer, and my background is distributed systems, databases, processing data in distributed systems, and security and cryptography. About processing data. So Ethereum was very interesting technology for me. Mm-hmm. And I was following it just like a hobby. Mm-hmm. I didn't have projects on ETH at that moment initially. But when the fork happened, when they decided to revert some transactions, because it's DAO and everything, the split happened between ETC and ETH, I just followed original blockchain, and apparently many people followed original blockchain, the miners, developers, and so on. So we formed a community. Mm-hmm. And there are actually many communities made by different people, like different Twitter channels, Twitter accounts. We even have two different GitHub organizations for Ethereum Classic, because it was just organized by different people, the community. Mm-hmm. So at some point, after a few more months working on EDC, I decided that I need to form a team just to work full time on EDC projects, on core protocol level stuff, on wallets, on libraries, on nodes appearing self, and so on virtual machines. And I formed EDC dev team. So we have a community, we have a EDC dev team, and other organizations working on EDC.
So our viewers might be confused. Ethereum Classic, what is it and how is it different from what we know as Ethereum?
Basically, that's the main difference from technology standpoint, mm-hmm. because any library for developer, you can migrate any projects from ETH to ETC, run any projects on ETH and ETC, because technology is the same blockchain, same consensus rules and everything. The minor differences, but nothing major. But later we realized that we are going to move in different directions. One of them, our main philosophy actually, that we preserve blockchain principles, like finality of transactions, like nobody can revert your transactions,
and so
immutability,
yes.
All that stuff. Second thing is, which is important for us, is decentralization. So we don't have and not going to have any central party, central authority, foundation, or whatever. So it's we separate technology as a protocol, as ETC, and people working on it. So we have different companies now. We have ETC Dev working on technology side, developers. We have another company, actually, IHK, working. They have their own client for ETC on the wallet, mm-hmm. and doing some of their own researches. And we have we have ETC Cooperative, which is an independent party, which does some kind of business development networking for projects working on ETC. They have their own budget and marketing, they are organizing events. One of them actually going to be here in Seoul, Korea in September.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, ETC Summit. So yeah, please come to the event. Yeah, it's really nice.
Of course.
The second event. I don't know details again because it's organized by ETC Cooperative Organization. I
So you mentioned a little bit about how you guys try to avoid having a centralized governing entity. Is that why, could it be the reason that you guys kind of focus on the POW algorithm?
Yeah, that's the part. So I actually was a big believer on the proof of stake. I was arguing so that we need to use proof of stake, research it and start using, because it's cheaper, you don't need mining and everything, a lot of benefits. But I had a lot of conversation for the past year. And we come to a conclusion, and I was convinced by many people, but many arguments, and it all makes sense. And now I'm big believer in proof of work. I was before, but proof of stake was interesting technology. Let's try it. Let's make experiment. And now we expecting some other people maybe making experiment with proof of stake. But Ethereum ETC is going to stay in proof of work for next year or two, at least. We don't see any safe technology, any safe consensus proof of stake that can be applied.
So you guys achieved a hard fork at the Ethereum 1,920th block, 20,000th block. So how did it and why did it happen, the hard fork from the Ethereum blockchain?
Yes. So we didn't do any hard fork, actually. ETH did a hard fork. They forked from original chain. We just followed. We didn't update any software. We original chain. So ETH made a hard fork on that block, and they followed their own chain. Oh. But because they have Vitalik and so on, it was marketed and so on, that's Ethereum, right? Mm-hmm. It should be opposite, actually. But anyway, it's... So we just followed the original chain. We didn't do anything. We just kept the original software for the time of the fork and continued development based on original software without applying these changes, reverse transactions.
Is that the reason why the name Classic got into
it? We didn't have any name even. It was just Ethereum. There was two Ethereum. So that, as I say, there is two organizations in GitHub for developers. One of them, first one, was called Ethereum Project. Just Ethereum Project, Ethereum Project, because it was that's real Ethereum for us. And it's real Ethereum. We didn't change it. So we didn't even make a decision, probably. Unexpected for us, Poloniex started to trade ETC, and they just called it ETC. So we had no choice after that.
I'm curious to ask, between the ETH developers and ETC developers, are you guys in any positive or negative relationship between you guys? Are there any hostility between you guys because
It's a people. Some people in our community, in the ETH community, there is conflict, right? I saw it many times. On the other hand, I have many good friends in ETC, developers and so on. So me and other team members of ETH. So people to people communications, and some friends, this wars between people. Oh, you're supporting ETH, as a project. I don't like what they're doing. This stuff, philosophical stuff. We don't accept that, right? But they have a lot of good engineers, good people. Mm-hmm. So
ETC planned and has successfully finished another fork on block, a 5.9 millionth one. Some refer to it as diffusing the difficulty bomb. So what is it and how has it changed the ETC system?
This difficulty bomb was initially added in early days of Ethereum to motivate developers to move to proof of stake. So idea of difficulty bomb to make mining, proof of work mining, inefficient. Exponentially increasing minimal difficulty for a block. So at some point it will be impossible to mine a blockchain. So it should force people to migrate to proof of stake. So we initially paused that bomb for a year after the fork, and I believe ETH did the same. I think it's paused now too. And during that time, so we were thinking, we're going to move to proof of stake or staying off proof of work and so on. We had a lot of discussions and realized that even if you want to move to proof of stake later, we don't want to use any bomb, like a gun. We don't want to have a viewpoint in negotiations. we want to have a healthy conversation with community, yes, with people. So we need to throw out this this bomb, remove it, and so we did it.
because if it's way too difficult, people are gonna start to, you know, avoid like getting into the Ether Classic maybe community. That's why is it why you decided to diffuse what they call a difficulty bomb?
Yeah, so we decided we can't keep it because it was already expensive to mine. Mm-hmm. So before we removed the difficulty, the block time was like 20 something seconds, like 25 seconds, 26 seconds, mm-hmm, I think. And now it returned back to normal, like 13, 14 seconds,
12 13, seconds. 14 seconds.
Yeah, so you see the difference. And hash power gave up. Like, I returned back to normal, actually, because it was, yeah, it wasn't, it was profitable for miners, mm-hmm, already. There was a little difficulty added by bomb at that moment, but it was already unprofitable for miners. So we just removed that, this artificial inefficiency in mining blockchain.
So moving on to the next part, you explained a little bit how you guys focus on the POW system, mm-hmm, but nowadays there are a lot of consensus algorithms coming up, such mm-hmm as DPoS, POS, mm-hmm, maybe Byzantium, mm-hmm, fault tolerance. Do you guys plan to stay on the POS system, or in the future you guys move on to another one?
So we're going to stay on proof of work for now, but we realized that we need to scale system, mm-hmm, blockchain, and we fully focused on scale solutions. So we have a few different ideas. We're making experiments on it's technical changes. So we basically want to at a standard idea, like in Bitcoin, you have Lightning Network, right? So mm-hmm, we want to make kind of similar for Ethereum. ETC, make a network of network, sidechains. It's usually called sidechains, so yeah, we keep the name. Sidechains, and we expect that business will use, they own a part of blockchain, independent, which can be proof of stake or deposit or whatever. It can have the some parameters optimized for them, for business, performance, cost of transactions, and whatever. And they own smart contracts. So that's our idea. But for main chain, for security, we're going to keep proof of work at least for next year too, because mm-hmm, we don't see an alternative.
Oh, okay. So your presentation today will deal with the topic of blockchain world. Mm-hmm. So as the CTO of a mainstream of blockchain, mm-hmm, how do you view the future?
I would like to know it too, because you know it's completely unexpected. I saw these changes many times. I mean, I see it's the same. It happened in '90s, before, and many times actually it happened for internet, for computers itself, for I don't know, for games, for mobile phones. It's always the same pattern that you can't predict the future. So but I see there is a lot of potential in blockchain and there is Bitcoin, which mm-hmm is a great product, and it will going to stay. And there is blockchains like Ethereum. Again, there are multiple Ethereum implementations. There's private nets, public nets. There is banks using some kind of Ethereum versions too. Like, so it's all based on Ethereum anyway. Mm-hmm. So we see that this blockchain will continue to grow and will be used in some networks in IoT, probably to making some systems, complex systems, decentralized systems, mm-hmm, not necessarily related to finance, to security, to digital assets, to ICO tokens or whatever.
So
it's really much bigger, actually.
The future is going to grow for the blockchain community whole crypto world?
It will be different. It will be, you know, I started this, I became a member of the community, mm-hmm, before the hype, when just developers were, mm-hmm, developing something on blockchain. And now we have a different community, and I don't know where it's going to go, mm-hmm, and probably we all see different future. But it's definitely going to go somewhere, and it will be, that will be 100 times bigger than now. And they will become split on, like, in internet. Yeah, there's like many technologies on the internet and many applications, types of applications, e-commerce applications, social networks on internet and so on. That will be same for blockchain space. There will be digital assets and other kinds of applications built on blockchain.
I mean, as a person who's involved in the blockchain community, I hope it works out well too. That is all the questions we have today. Thank you for your time, Mr. Atomanov.
Thank you for inviting me.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in. That was Mr. Igor Atomanov, the CTO of Ethereum Classic. Thank you.
Thank you.